is an interesting platform as a service. It allows you to upload files, so it has Firebase storage, and it also has a real-time database as well as Firebase functions. So it kind of provides you a platform for serverless applications. And Svelte, the front-end UI framework slash compiler, is quite ready to exploit the benefits of Firebase. So today, let's build a real-time photo guest book. So where we will have a form for people to write something, a comment, and then upload a picture, and then those signed guest book entries, they show up on your page, sort of like comments or something like that. So let's get started. We will go through the entire process of setting up a Firebase project and installing the Firebase command line tool, etc. And then we will set up a Firebase Firestore database with a collection in it for our guest book, and we will upload files. We will resize them also in the browser. So let's see if we can do this. All right, so here's my Visual Studio. I am going to first install Firebase tools. So basically, the way you do that is sudo npm install globally firebase dash tools. So once you do that, so this is the first thing we do so that we can create we can manage our Firebase for the most part from the command line, especially for deployments and creation of projects, etc. So we will do that. So I'll let this finish. Right. In the meanwhile, here in the browser, I'm going to take you to firebase.com. And there, this is me logged in. If I click on the Firebase console, so this takes me to the Firebase console, and I have a few projects. I'm going to, rather than clicking Add Project here, I'm going to do it here. So now that Firebase tools are installed, let me first start a Svelte project. So let me cd to Svelte, my Svelte working directory, and I will say npxdegit svelte js slash template, and then I will call this let me call this insta guest book, because it's going to be a guest book that you can sign with some text and a picture, sort of like Instagram kind of thing. All right, so let's create that. Oops, I think I misspelled. Let me correct the spelling of template. There it is. Okay, we did that. Let's open that project, Insta guest book. And the first thing we will do is we will say npm install. Once we go there, this will download our dev dependencies, which is in here, and all the dependencies, including rollup plugins and Svelte itself. All right, now that we have that, we can go into npm scripts and hit dev, which will start the server. And there it is. So this is our dev server. So this is standard. All right, now the first thing we want to do is we want to start a Firebase project. So let's do that. So here we are. Oops, sorry, I opened a new one. I meant to use an existing one. All right, so first thing I have to do is run Firebase init. Remember, this is because I can use Firebase because I have installed Firebase tools. So let me install, say, Firebase init. And that says what all, so this is going to create a Firebase project in the current directory. What are the things that I want to use? I don't want to use real-time database. I want to use Firestore, which is better than real-time database. It gives you all the features, and then it's kind of better. I want to use Firestore? I want to use hosting. I want to use storage for uploading. Okay, and I don't want to use other things. So Firestore for storing real-time data collections, hosting so that I can deploy it to Firebase, and then storage so that I can upload my images to Firebase. All right, let's press enter. Do I want to create a new project or existing project? Let's create a new project, and I will call it Insta Guest Book. All right, what would you call the project? Same as the idea, I guess. Let's call it Insta Guest Book. So creating Google Cloud Platform project. Let's see. Now these things don't always work reliably. Sometimes they give you very weird problems. So we will see. Hopefully we don't run into those, but if we do, then we will deal with them. So right now it's creating a project. All right, so we got an error. So what's the error? The cloud resource location is not set for this, but operation you are attempting to perform, Cloud Firestore requires it. Okay, so yes, I have seen this problem. The resource location, this is the classic issue. So what we have to do is go into our Firebase console, which is console.firebase.google.com, refresh it, and hope maybe our project will be here, maybe it won't, we'll see. And let's see. Did we get, yeah, there it is, the Insta guest book. And the issue here is that we have not, so for Firestore, we have to specifically create a location. So let's go to Cloud Firestore, this one. Click on this. So this error, because we have not set a location, that's the issue. So let's set a location. We go in here. And then we say Cloud Firestore real-time database. We don't want to use real-time database. We want to use this. So we click Create Database, and then it says start in production mode or start in test mode. I don't know if I want. I'm anyway going to change this, so it doesn't matter. Let's start in production mode. What's the big deal, right? So after, okay, now we have to set the location. So here, US Central, yeah, let's take the default. So once you do this, things will go better, hopefully. So the Firebase command line tool is somehow not very good about setting reasonable default. So it's provisioning the Cloud Firestore, setting up security rules. Good. Once that is done, I should be able to deploy it again. Let's hope it does. Okay, so this finished. Let's try this again. Firebase init. Do the same things. Firestore, hosting, and storage. Press enter. This time we have to say use existing project, okay? Because we have already created it. So yeah, this Insta guest book is what I'm going to use. You will definitely name it something else. What file should be used for Firestore rules? Yes, take the default. What file should be used for Firestore indexes? Take the default again. What do you want to use as your public directory? That's public, sure. Configure is as a single page app, rewrite all rules to index.html. Say yes, because yeah, I do want to make it a single page application so that every URL goes to index.html. And then file public index.html already exists. Do you want to overwrite? Say no. You don't want to overwrite because you are running a Svelte project, it has its own index.html. What file should be used for storage rules? So yes, take the default again, and everything worked. This is good. This is nice. So now, at this point, we should be able to deploy. Let's see if we are able to deploy. Now, what we do is we say npm run build. like this. So hit run build. Okay, and back in here we can run Firebase deploy. Let's see if that works. Once that succeeds, we will simply create a new script that will do that automatically, the build and deploy somewhere in the package.json. Looks like yes, that worked. Let's see if insta guestbook.firebase.com works. So there it is. Okay, good. So our application, our Svelte application is now deployed here on insta-guestbook.firebase-app.com. Good, so that's good. Let's edit the package.json such that it has a script for what we want to do, which is we just say deploy script, and it simply says npm run build, and then Firebase deploy. And then don't forget to give a comma to end this. And now, if you just hit, and in npm scripts, if you hit deploy, it does the same thing. At this point, you won't see any changes because you haven't made any changes. So let's, now that we have our basic Svelte application deploying to Firebase hosting, next, we have to now start adding Firebase features to it. We will start by adding login and authentication. So what I want to do is, I want to create a component called login, okay? So in order to do that, I have to create a new folder. I'll create a new folder and a file. Let's do both in one shot. We will call it src/firebase/login.svelte. Okay, so here, what I'm doing is I am I have to initialize Firebase. So first, remember we added Firebase tools to our npm install -g, the globally installed one. We have to add Firebase to the current project, which is not the Firebase command line tools, but the Firebase libraries. So in order to do that, what we will do is we will go in here in bash and say npm install, save as a runtime dependency, and we will install Firebase. So this will add Firebase, the API, to our project in package.json. Once that happens, we will be able to log in. Now, I want every user of my guestbook to log into Firebase, or log into Google, rather, mainly. So then only I want them to sign. I don't want them to sign without logging in, okay? So let's see. Okay, that seems to have worked. All right, let's, now what we have to do is we want to create a login button. The way you do that is, this is login.svelte. I will create a script inside that, and then I say import Firebase app from @firebase/app. So this is where you get your basic the Firebase app from. Then you want to add authentication. Now keep in mind that you just say import fire. You don't say import what from what. You just say import @firebase/auth. This is weird. This is a little bit weird, but this is needed for needed for side effect, which means it adds new features to this Firebase object, and that being auth authentication. So now that we have that, we will simply we have to initialize Firebase. So this part we have to do in Firebase. So let's go to Firebase. And this is Insta guestbook. Let me go to the project. So if I go to, okay. So what I want I have to do is I have to go to the project overview. In authentication, and we have to add a sign-in method. The sign-in method that I will add So let me make sure that you understand this. I went to this menu, I clicked on this gear and went to project settings. Sorry, that's not where I want to go. I want to go to authentication in my project. And now I go to sign in method and enable Google as a sign in method. So there it is. I am going to enable Google, and it says what you want a project support. I'll just put my email address, whitelist, client IDs, and all that good stuff. I think we can do that. Let's just hit save. So now we have localhost, instaguestbook.firebaseapp.com, and instaguestbook.web.app. So all these are authorized domains. And Google, wait, did I not enable it? Okay, sorry. Yeah, I have to enable Google. Okay, good. So now that that is enabled, we have enabled authentication. So now that we have done that, we will be able to, first we have to initialize Firebase. Firebase needs configuration. So the configuration for Firebase can be obtained from here. I go to project settings, and in project settings, there is this web icon. So this web icon has, I have to enable everything. So you say yes, set up Firebase hosting. This is, take the defaults basically, create an Instaset book. Okay. No. InstaGuestBook, yes. Now what? Add a web app. Why is it not showing me everything that I need to see? Let me check. Register app, my web app. Okay. Let's call it Insta Guest Book. Register app. And next, it shows you some code. You can ignore that. We are not using it like this. Install Firebase CLI, we already did. And there is some other information. All this is irrelevant. What is relevant to us is once you have set up that web SDK, go to this config. Okay. And in this config, whatever it says, just copy that and store that, and let me show you store it where. Create another file in here called config.js. Okay, and in here you just say export default, and then you export default whatever object you're going to get from this. So when you in this config, whatever is provided to you, just copy that, and that's your. So I just copy this, and I will paste it. Actually, yeah, that's it. So and I can get rid of this. And now the whole configuration is exported. Okay, so. Now that we have this, there is API key and secret and all kinds of, so you don't want to commit this, okay? So just keep in mind, do not commit this config.js. Maybe commit a skeleton for it. Okay, so now that you have that, you can import that into, so import config from dot slash config. Now, you just say fire if Firebase has already not been initialized, which is possible, you know, maybe it has been initialized. So you can check that by saying if firebase.app is false. If no Firebase app, that means it has not been initialized. And then what should you do? Just say firebase.initializeApp, and in there you give it the config. That's it. So once you do this, you have Firebase config. And Firebase app initialized. Once you do these things, now you can go on with the business of logging in. So what we will do is we will create a login button. And the way we will do that is we will let's create a login button. Let's say button, call it login, and close the button. And then we say on click. This is Svelte, of course, event handler on click, and we will call the login JavaScript function. Let's create the login JavaScript function. We can just say function login, and in there what it does, it says Firebase dot auth, and auth is a function, so you have to call it as a function, and then you say sign in with pop-up, so that it creates a pop-up, and as an argument you have to give it a an authentication provider. So there are many authentication providers. The one that we initialized, we enabled it, if you remember, was the one for Google, right? So sign in method was Google. So the way you do that is you say new firebase.auth dot Google authentication, Google auth provider. So once you take this, and then you have to call it as a constructor. So of course you're saying new. Once you do those things, you have authentication. But the problem is this is asynchronous. So you want to await for it. So you have two choices. You either await like this or you say dot then. But I like async await, so that's what I will do. I will make this function async, and then prefix this with await. Assign this to const result. So if you, and then we can print result if we want, but I do know what result looks like. It contains a user. So what I will do is I will create a local variable let user, which is initially undefined, and then say when this thing succeeds and I have awaited it, then assign user as result dot user. And then just for our convenience, we can also print it. So let's console dot log user. Let's print this. Okay. So once we do these things, our login will start working, hopefully. Let's see if it does, right? So save this. Once we save this, let's hit dev. Let's restart. I think we should restart because we have added new. Oh, one thing I forgot to do is I forgot to include login in my app. So I go back to my app. And let's remove all this extra stuff. In fact, in main.js itself, I don't need this props world. Okay, and in the app, I don't want any of the styles. I'll just use plain vanilla. And in script, I say import login from login from Firebase slash login dot svelte, I think. Yep, that's right. So we can just now instantiate the login component. Save it, save all everything, and let's hope this thing works. I go back to my localhost 5000, reload it. Okay, so there is a login button. Let me position this right next to my my VS Code. I will, okay, before I do that, let me separate this window. Okay, and I will split screen this. Okay, so hopefully this is good. I do want to see the console, so inspect console, and I'm going to hit login. Okay, something went wrong. No Firebase app has been created. All Firebase, okay. So that didn't work. So something is wrong with the way I am doing this. So no, if no Firebase app, then initialize app. Looks like that doesn't work. Firebase. Okay. So what I should do instead is there is another variable called Firebase.apps. So I can say Firebase if Firebase.apps.length is 0. Okay, how about this? Or I can say if no Firebase.apps.length, if it is falsy, then initialize. Let's see if this works. Okay, so this what I'm saying is if Firebase has no apps initialized, then please initialize something with this config. Let's hit login. Okay, it did something. Oh yeah, it's doing the pop-up. Okay, so and then it lets me log in with it says continue to instaguestbook.firebaseapp.com, etc., etc. I say yes, use this account, and once I do that, it should close itself. Yes, and I'm logged in, and it printed the user. And when you expand that user, there are a few useful things. There's the display name, and there is a photo URL. Okay. And there is email address, email verified true. So there are a lot of useful things. Let's use this to print. Now, by the way, it still shows login. Now, once we have logged in, it shouldn't show login. So what we can say is pound sign if user, then do one thing. Else, if there is no user, then let them log in. Okay, so the login button shows only if you are not logged in. And then if you are logged in that situation, we should show some information about the user. So let's say we are showing the name of the user, and this will be user.displayName, like this. And then let's say we want to show the picture of the user. So img src equal to user.photo URL. As you can see here, it says photo URL, right? So that's what we will use, photo URL. And we do, Svelte encourages you to give alt, so we will give alt as, let's say user, sorry, $ user dot display name. Let's say photograph, or let's say photo off, right? So this can be the alt. Let's close the image. Okay, I forgot, I mistyped. It should be display with a Y. All right, let's save this. And now when we log in, select this user. Look. We got Jitesh Doshi with the picture. Very nice. Now, if I use a different, we should also allow logout. So let's allow logout. We basically say give a button, and that on click, we will call the logout function, and let's call this logout button. Okay. So now let's create the function. So once again, we'll say async function logout, and what it does is it will call firebase.auth dot sign out. There it is, sign out. So we just call sign out. Hopefully that should be good enough. And then we will set user to null. And this we should probably await for because asynchronous function. So if I do that, let's see if this works. So log in. That's the pop-up. And I select, let's click my different email address, different Google account. Okay, so yes, so it shows, but the picture is too big. And it can log out if I click log out. Yeah, log out works. I think it does. We'll see. But the problem with this is that the picture was too big. So we should have some control over the size of the image. So what we should do is let's call it, let's wrap this in div.profile. So a class profile, okay. And then what we will do is we will give style, and we say dot profile containing an image. Let's call this, give this an image class. Let's say, well, it doesn't need to, but let's say profile, right? So then we can say dot profile containing image dot profile should be of a certain size. Let's say width 80 pixel or 50 pixels and height 50 pixel. Okay, so if I now reformat and save it and go through login again. So that's one of my profiles showing the picture. Maybe the logout should be on the next line, but okay, still kind of works. And then if I log out and then log in again, this time I log in as a different user. And then this time, okay, so the picture is not super huge like it was last time. So that's very good. We don't have to console log anymore. Also, the image should basically show as a block. So let's say display block. So this way, when we log in, it doesn't allow the logout button on the same page. Same line. It breaks the line. Let's hit that. And there you go. Now logout button is on the next line. Good. So this is our login component. Let's go over it again, what we are doing here. We are checking, we are importing Firebase from at Firebase app. We are importing at Firebase auth with no alias, no import name, no JavaScript objects or functions, symbols assigned to it. And then that's because we want to do this for us for the side effects. Without this, Firebase.auth will not work. Okay, so it simply add to the app, so to the main Firebase symbol. Then we say if there is no Firebase.apps.length, meaning to say if it is zero, that is, then we say Firebase.initialize app, and then we give it an argument, the config object. The config object is something that we got from let me just recap. We got the config object when we went to our Firebase console. We went into project settings, and in this project settings, we have this config. We had to enable web. Keep that in mind. We had to enable web once we went all this, and then we got the config. This config is what we have assigned here. And I basically stored it in a file. And that config object was passed into Firebase.initialize app. Once all that is done, you can have a login, logout buttons, functions. The login function simply calls Firebase auth, sign in with pop-up, and then give it a provider, which is Google provider in this case. And you have to await on the result, and then result.user is your user. And then from that user, you can get the user.photo URL or user.displayName. You can also get user.email if you want. Now that we are logging in, next we have to create a table or a collection in Firestore and enter the guestbook sign in comment, I guess. Okay. So next, what we will do is we will create a component. Let's create a component, not inside Firebase. Let's create it inside this. Let's create a new. We can create it inside Firebase. Either way is fine. Let's create a new file called guestbook.svelte. So now guestbooks.svelte is going to represent the collection, and everything, the eForm, as well as a listing of guestbook entries. Let's start with a script tag. And what we will do is we will import, just like we did in our login, we will import some of these standard things, Firebase and auth. But instead of auth, we will import storage. Not storage, sorry, Firestore. So Firestore is the database, okay? It's not same as the real-time database. It is a real-time. It is a database, but it's a different kind of real-time database. All right, so let's do this. Now, what we have to do is, okay, so hold on one second. I'm just gathering my thoughts here. Yeah, so what we will do next is we will say firebase.firestore, and then we have to get a collection from it. So we can say collection, the collection name that we are going to use. So what is the collection? Collection is basically going to show up here in my database. There will be a collection. And we will call, I'm going to call that collection guestbook. Let's call this guestbook. Okay. There's your guestbook collection. Let's assign this to something const collection is equal to guest, like this guestbook. And now within this collection, we can add new entries. Okay. So let's start with a form. We will say form, there will be no action. We will not have action in our form because we will simply say when on submit, just prevent. So pipe, this is modifier called prevent default. And then, but instead do this submit function. Okay, and we will write the submit function. We can make it async again because we are going to await inside async function, submit. And what we do inside, we'll come back to that. But in here, we will have an entry, just a piece of text. So input, you can say type text, but that's not needed. We'll just say placeholder, say something. Okay, this is your guestbook entry, so you're saying something for your guestbook entry. Let's make it required. And most importantly, let's bind it to something. So what will we bind it to? We will bind it to a guestbook record. So let's say something called record equal to an empty object. And then this is the title of the entry. So let's call it title. And then value is empty. Okay, so this is your guestbook record. Actually, this let's call this empty record. Why are we calling this empty record? Is because we will reset this form, and every time it resets, it should reset back to an empty record. And this, on the other hand, record itself will be the empty record. It will be initialized to empty record. So here I'm using the spread operator, and I'm saying whatever is in the empty record, just clone that, make a copy of it. All right, so now we have in our input box, we will say bind the value of this input box to record dot title. Okay, let's save this, and now we need to have a submit button, so let's call it button type is submit. This is what will trigger the submit event, and let's call this submit and close it. Okay, let's see if this works. Save it. I don't know, didn't show up. Oh, of course it didn't show up because guestbook.svelte is not imported anywhere. So we have to go to app.svelte and import guestbook from firebase/guestbook.svelte, and then we will display it. Okay, save this. All right, so now we have say something. Now, let's take a look at our collection. So there is no collection right now, and I am going to simply say something, say first entry, and hit submit. All right, so when I did it do anything? I don't know, it doesn't look like it did. Did it fail? Let's check. No, I didn't have a failure also. Of course, it didn't do anything because our submit function is completely empty. What we should do here is we have this collection, right? So we should use the collection.add and then add a record to it, and that will be our record. Record already has title in it. So let's see if this works. Okay. And we can await on it if you want. Let's await on it. Okay, so we save this and say first entry, hit submit. Oh, we got an error. It says missing or insufficient permissions. That's because we did not log in. I think. Let's find out. So one of the issues is, yes, so this is where our Firebase Firestore rules come into the picture. This, what we have to do is, right now in production, it says write if false, which means allow everyone to read, do not allow anyone to write. We have to fix this. What we should do is, we should say allow read to everyone, and then allow write if request.auth is not equal to null. So allow write only if you are, allow write only if you are logged in, okay? So right now, if I go to my rules for my database, so it has the same rules, if false. So that's not gonna work. So let's, we change it, we say allow read to all, and allow write if the user is logged in, okay? Let's hit deploy. As you know, deploy will build the project and then deploy it to Firebase. Let's hope that works better this time. Okay. Still deploying. Cool, deploy complete. Let's see if that changes here. So if I refresh this page, I should see the new rules. And I do see them. Excellent. So now Firestore rules have changed. Let's try this again. First entry, hit submit. Okay, no errors. So maybe it worked, maybe it didn't. We can find out by clicking on data. And look, I have a new collection called guestbook in which I have a new entry called first entry. Excellent. This is our first successful save to Firestore database. So now, next thing we want to do is we want to show these entries as they come. Also, I should probably reset this, okay? So, I mean, the first entry should disappear once it has been saved. So I go back here in my guestbook, and I will say, await for this, and then once that is done, record equal to dot, 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 empty record. So this way, it resets. So this will reset itself. The second thing I want to do is I want to show a list of entries, correct? So I will, in my guestbook, I will create an unordered list. And then in that unordered list, I want to say for each records as record. Now, I'll just rec. And I will explain. Now, obviously, we don't have anything called records. We have to create that. Let's close the each. And in here, we will have a list item. And it will say something like rec.title, which is the title that we are saving with the record. Now, first thing we have to do is create something called records. So let's say let records equal to an empty array. Okay. So that's not going to be, that's not what we really want. What we want is, we want the records to be initialized from this collection, whatever is in the collection. So what we do is, in the very beginning, we simply say, okay, when we initialize the collection, we say collection dot snapshot on snapshot, correct, on snapshot. This will give us a snapshot of the collection in real time. That's the best part. As soon as the, so let's call it the snap, and then we can do something with it, and that do something will be snap. When we get the snapshot, we will what is it, docs, I guess, I think. So we will get all the docs from that, and we will map them to so when we get a snapshot, we will say, go into the snapshot, get all the documents, map them in such a way that the document D is appended to records somehow, right? So D dot data, yeah. So get the data and then assign one. So every document is mapped to its data, and then it's assigned to, the whole thing is assigned to records. So, okay, I think this should work. Let's see. Yeah. Yep. That should be. Okay, let me explain what this is doing. We are saying you have a collection. Every time the collection snapshot changes, take the snapshot here, go into its documents, map each document to from document to document.data. And then now you have an array of these document data arrays, and assign that to records. Let's see if this works. I mean, we'll find out. Okay, let me, okay, did it? It didn't really, I don't think. Let me just reload this, maybe it will. Oh, yes, it's kind of there. Yeah, first entry right there. It did, right. So if I come back here and create a second entry, okay, I can create it either here, I say second entry, and hit submit. That created my second entry. And it has also been saved here, right? If I create a third entry from by add document, let me see. Add document. Document ID will be auto, and the title field will be, let's call it third entry, and I hit save. And now if I come back to my application, third entry has already been added. How is that working? Well, collections on snapshot callback is being invoked, and it's being given a new snapshot. And every time it gets a new snapshot, it goes into all of its documents in the snapshot, maps each document to document data. There is also a record ID in that, or the ID in each document, that is separate. So we are not assigning those, I guess. So we could see these also. Now let's improve it on it a little bit. So this is beginning to look like a guest book, right? Let's improve upon it a bit. We are ignoring the IDs at this point. Let's add the IDs to it. So instead of records being a record of just the data, let's make it a record of ID and data. So what we will do is, instead of returning just the data, let's put it in an array, and we return the data, but first we return data d dot id. So id as well as data. So now what happens is, records is not just an array of data, document data. It's an array of arrays. Each one, so it will be something like this. It will be id and data. And then there will be id and data like this. This is how it's going to be. So when we get here, we will print the ID. We say records as record data and ID. So we will call it ID data. Okay. And then since this is a collection of Svelte components, we can give this as the key. So as you know, in the pound sign each block, the you can put this as the in parentheses you give the key, and we will now we can also use this ID in here as like in curly braces, it's a local variable, and let's put a colon in front just to show us what the IDs are. And now you can see, you see, that's the ID colon first entry, ID colon second entry, ID colon third entry. So this is the that's the ID and the title. Okay, but let's hide them. I don't think we should show them. So let's say it's title equals ID. How's that? When you hover now, when you hover on the LI, you will hopefully see the ID. So when I hover on it, I guess not. The title is not showing. Let me inspect it. Yeah, so there is title, but it's not actually showing on hover. I thought it would, but oh yeah, it is. It is showing. Yeah, I was just, it just I just had to wait a little bit. Okay, so this way we can see the IDs. So at this point, we have a couple of the features implemented. Did you notice that it did not make us log in to sign the guest book? That's because we are already logged in. It just isn't showing that. So if I type this, it shows. But any case, now how about we delete these entries as well? So I want to be able to delete it. How do I delete it? Let's put a delete button. Okay. So next to each of these LIs, let's put this in a paragraph. Okay. And I'll say record.title and then delete this part. I save this. So this will show up as it in a paragraph, which is fine. Now I want to add a delete button. Okay. So let's see if I can add a delete button. Button, delete, close button. And then on click, I want to say remove, let's say. So now remove, of course, needs to be a function. As usual, I'll make it an async function, remove, and it removes a given ID. So I say collection, go to the collection, and then get a document by its ID. So let's accept the ID, right? And then collection, and then delete it, right? And then await on it. Okay, so why is there an error there? It's because I misspelled async. Async should be spelled like that. So, which means that remove needs an argument. So since this is a callback, we have to create a lambda function and then remove with the ID. So provide it with the ID. So now, if I save this, okay, so now we have the delete button. And if I click the delete button, it actually deletes it. How do we know it deletes it? You can see it here. See, the second and third entry are here, but the first entry is gone. Another thing is, I don't want the delete button to be so prominent and you know, obvious like this. So what I have to do is, I have to let's make this position absolute and put it on the right hand side. Top right. So the way we do that is, let's give this LI a class. Let's call it record, class record, right? And now give it a style. So style dot record, make it position relative. And then within that, this button, let's call give it another class, class delete. Right. Oops, I misspelled it. Delete. And then we will say in record you have dot delete class, and that is position absolute, and then we'll say top is 0 pixel, right is 0 pixel. Okay, let's see if this works. Save it. And now it's all the way to the right. Good. Okay, so this is kind of helpful. If I click it again, so I've deleted everything and all my entire guest book is empty. So far so good. One of the things is that it should do this only if I'm logged in. The delete I don't want everyone to be able to do. So in my Firestore rules, I can say allow delete, right, colon, if request dot auth dot UID is equal to my UID. And I can find out my own UID by going to authentication. And there it is, Jitesh at spinspire.com, and I copy this user UID. Once I do that, I can paste it here. And now it should, once I deploy it, it will not allow any random person to delete my entries. So you can use that. Any case, now at this point, of course, this is a photo guest book. I want to be able to upload pictures. That's the whole point, right? So in order to do that, I have to start, I have to allow file uploads, okay? So let's do that. What we do is we go into guestbook and we add in our form, we add a input type file, and then we have to, and once we do that, it will be allow us to upload files, but we want to upload only image files. So image slash, we say add an accept attribute. Okay. And this will allow us to upload files. Okay. So this is showing side by side. Let's give a line break between the two. Okay. All right. So this will let us say something and choose a file. If I click choose file, you will notice how it does not allow me to upload anything other than images, which is good. That's what I was going for. Now, what we will do is on change. So on change, we want to upload. So that's a function that we have to add. All right, so let's add again, async as usual, because these things are usually asynchronous. Call it upload. And then it will receive an event. So let's take E as the event parameter. And we will simply console.log E.target, which is the input type file, dot files. This is the key thing. Okay. So if I now hit choose file, and then I find my little picture. Yeah, this one. And if I say press enter, oops, I should be looking at the console. Okay, yes, so this is printing files, and in there is length equal to 1, and the 0th element is the name of the file, and then last modified date, type is image JPEG, and so on and so forth. Okay, so now we want to upload this to Firestore. So in order to Firestore upload it, we just, sorry, not Firestore, I mean storage, Firebase storage. So this is another, we are doing this again, first for side effect. So now that we have storage available to us, all we have to do is point to a storage ref. So what we do is say Firebase dot storage. So get storage, and then we get the ref to the storage, right? So this is the storage ref, and then we can get a child reference, which means we can upload it directly there, or we can get to a child. But I think we can just do that. So this gives us the storage, ref. What is a ref? Ref is basically an object, JavaScript object that gives you reference to the storage bucket. Okay, and now we will be able to upload things to storage ref. Sorry, not store ref. Let's call it storage ref. Once we do that, we can, in my upload, all I have to do is if e.target.files and e.target.files.length is greater than 0, then we have, the user has selected some files, right? So we will just say const file equal to e.target.files 0. Just take the 0th file, which is what this thing is, right? And now all you have to do is say storage ref dot child, create a child under that with its name should be equal to the file dot name, which would be this name, correct? And then to upload, just say put, that's it, and give it the file. That's all there is to it. Let's hope this works. Let's save this. If this works, we are in business. Now, there's one more thing. When we do that, we want to store. We want to store the name of the file along with the record. Okay. So what we will do is we will say, let's await this. And when it succeeds, then we say record.file is equal to file.name. So whatever the name you uploaded. Now, the thing is, in our empty, the prototypical record, we should say file is null. Okay, so that, you know, when you haven't uploaded anything, it's null. So now, when we save this, let's see if this works. I say, you know, first entry, and then I hit choose file. I will choose my file, this one, press enter. Did it upload? We don't know. Let's submit anyways, and it did save something. Let's go back to our Firebase console and see if anything really worked. Let's go to the database, and in the database, we should have one entry, we do, and the file is jitesh-sm.jpg. That's good. And then in storage, we should have a file. Looks like storage is not doing anything. Okay, this may not be good. Let's see, get started. It says, by default, your rules allow all reads and writes from authenticated users. After you define your data structure, you will need to write rules to secure your data. I think this is fine. Let's hit next. It's asking me to select a location. I will say, yeah, sure, select it, the default location. Now, I suspect my file upload did not work, but we will deal with it in a second. Apparently it did work. Okay, now the rules wise, it says, allow read or write only if the user is logged in. I want to allow read for everyone and write only if they are logged in. So which means I go back in my project and I look up my storage rules. Where are those storage rules? Yes, so storage rules right there. And what I'll do is I will copy this. I'll say allow read from everyone and allow write if the user is logged in. Okay. So that's what I'm going to. So let's save this. And if I hit deploy, it should work. But before, so why don't we just go ahead and deploy? Once the deployment finishes, our rules should work better. Now, Firebase has its own little language for defining the rules. So you might have to learn it. I didn't bother to actually learn it. I just looked at some examples and it seems to work for me. So if I now reload this, these rules should change. There it is. That's good. So that means write is allowed only if you are authenticated, but read is allowed for everyone. Now when I show these entries, I want to start showing those pictures, right? So for that, what I have to do is I have to go into my guest book, and I have to add an image. img src equal to what? Now that's a question. We'll get to it. What we have is a we have to have a URL, download URL for each image. Now we know that each record is going to have .file, right? So we just have to get that a reference to that file in the storage bucket. So the way we do that is, let's see. If you had the storage ref, what you would do is you would say storage ref dot child, and then that will be the record dot file, and then you would have to say get download URL. But this is an async function, so you would have to await it. Okay. So in order to achieve that, what we will do here is we will say pound sign await. So this is where Svelte helps us out by giving us pound sign await, and we will await on storage ref dot child rec dot file, right? And then get download URL, and we do have to await on it. And while we are awaiting, we can say then URL. So hold on. While we are awaiting, we can say loading dot dot dot. Let's put that in a paragraph. So if it's taking some time to load, once it has resolved, the promise has resolved, then it should be assigned to a variable called URL, okay? And that should be displayed as img src is the URL, so, and then alt should be whatever, picture, guest book, or we could just put the name of rec.file. This will be the alt. And then we close the await. Okay, let me explain this again, what we are doing. We have rec.file, which points to the file. We have the storage ref. We find the child of that storage bucket that is named same as this file. Get the download URL for it. This, mind you, is an asynchronous operation. That's why we have to await it. And while we are waiting, we say loading dot dot dot. And then once we are done, we replace it with image src. So let's see if this works. Save it. And da-da-da-da-da-da. Okay, well, wait. Maybe I have to reload this. I hope. Okay, yes, that worked. So it did work. Good. Let's test it by doing something like, say, second entry. And then I will choose file. Hopefully I choose wisely. I don't know. I'll just choose some random images like this one, for example, right? So I did that, and I have to hit submit. So I submitted, and now I have some picture. It's a little bit large picture, and we will fix that problem later. Now, if I hit delete, it will delete the, so if I go back into my Firebase console, in the database, there are, in the database, there are, so it's first entry and second entry, right? But in the storage, there should be two images, and they are. That's good. But if I delete a record, it will delete my database record, but it will not delete the image. I want it to delete the image as well. So what I will do is I'll come back to my remove method. First, I will delete the image. So I say await storage ref dot child, and now I want the file to be available. So I will have to say file as an argument, and then we say child file dot delete. Okay, so now of course we have to supply the file. Let's supply it here. In here is a rec.file. So this will give us the name of the file to delete. So let's save this. Okay, so this thing reloads. Now, when I delete this first entry, it's got deleted, let's see, from the database, hopefully. Yes, it's gone from the database. And from storage, yes, it's gone from the storage also. Now, if I once again delete this, it deleted from the storage the file, the image, and from database the record. So this is turning out to be a decent photo guestbook. Okay. Now there is one problem. As you saw, those images that I had, so if I say, you know, first entry again, let's see, you will see that these images are of different sizes, and I'm not super happy about that. So if I hit submit, this is okay, it's a decent size, but then if I make a second, oh, by the way, we have a bug here. It's not removing the Jitesh sm.jpg. So let's fix that. We will have to reset this. How do we reset it? Okay, let me see if there is a, I don't know. So when we do this save, there it is. Upload is there. Once that is done, I think once it has been uploaded, once it has been saved, let's reset it. So we say submit. If submit has an event, we can say e.target.reset. Is that such a function? Is there a function called reset? I don't know. Let's find out. If I save this, delete it again. I want to reset this form basically. So first entry, choose file, Jitesh small, and I will hit submit. And yes, it did reset. You see how it cleared? Well, that's good. So that worked. It did the form, basically e.target is the form, and we called this reset method of that form. That kind of is nice. All right, next, what we have to do is, if we upload another picture, let's see, second entry, and if I choose file, and then it has, let me use one of the pictures here. Okay, and then if I hit submit, see the problem is it's a very big picture. This is too big. I don't want this. I want something, want it to be reasonably sized. So that's where we use an image cropper. So in browser image resizer. So browser, if I search for browser image resize. So there is an NPM package called browser image resizer. And this has, so you just have to add it using this script. So let me just copy this, okay? And I will add this to my head, okay? So the way we will do that is, we will say svelte head, and in there I put the script. Okay, so this is the browser image resizer, right? Okay, and so this part is, I guess, standard. Oops, what happened here? Why this? Okay, that's fine. And then once you do that, back in here, they show an example on how to use it. So there should be a demo somewhere in here. is the browser image resizer? Okay, here, code sandbox in browser, this one. This shows you an example. So what it does is it looks for, it uses this from window.browserImageResizer.read and compress image. Okay, so I'm going to use the same thing. I come back here and I'm going to say, hey, when you upload the image, so let's go to our upload. Where is the upload? Yeah, here, upload. So when we upload, we will say, before you upload this file, see if you can resize it. So we say, if window.browserImageResizer, I think that's what it's called. Yeah, that's one, this. Right? If this exists, then do the resizing, which means, and I'll show what that means. And if that exists, then take the image. So this is event.target.files, and you get the image, which is going to be, so we say window.browserImageResizer. And it says read and compress image. So that's what we will do, read and compress image. And we supplied the file. And then what you get in return from is going to be the blob for the image. So we will say const blob equal to. So this is, keep in mind, this is not the this is not another file. This is the blob. Okay. So it returns a blob. And then what we will do is we will do the same thing, which is upload. Just like we were uploading the file, we will upload the blob, right, instead of file. And then, but if such a thing is not available, then just upload the file as is without any resizing. Now, of course, we have to provide in this read and compress image, you have to provide some options. So we will say, you know, give it a nice quality. So these are the options, and you can learn this from the documentation here, that you have to specify quality, max width, max height, auto rotate, etc. So I'm just going to say quality 0.8 and max width, I'll say 400, then max height, I'll say 400. So that, oops, height needs a T in there. Yeah, so if I do all these things, save it. Now, what will happen is it will take the original image and it will resize it at this quality and max width and max height, and then get the blob, and it's the blob that it will upload. So let's do this. Let's delete this one. Okay. And then I will say second entry, choose a file, and the file is going to be, let's see. So it's been uploaded. Oh, well, I don't know if it has been uploaded or not, but let's hit submit. And it didn't work. Something didn't work. Okay. So let's inspect. Maybe there is an error here. Yes, I do see an error. So there is Firebase storage error. What is the storage error? Let's see. Firebase invalid argument in child at index 0. So something didn't quite work. Let me check where the error might be. Let's see, blob. Let's see. In this example, do I have an error? Let me check something here. I am looking for some clue. Let me see. Okay. So here's the issue. What I get, okay, this is the problem. I made a mistake. I did not await it. I have to await this because it's a promise. So this will be a promise. So that was my issue. It returns a promise. So let's do this again. So there is an error. You see, last time we saved something bad. So let's fix that by simply deleting that particular entry. So we come back here and we go into our database and we will delete that second entry. This one, we'll just delete it. Oh, file is null. Okay, well, let's delete it anyway. I mean, what we can do is we can check if file is not null, then only show it. So here, we just say if rec.file, then only do any of this. Otherwise, don't show it. So here we go. Let's hope this works. And save it. And good. See, so now so let's delete the second entry anyways. Oops, something didn't quite. It says, okay, that's fine. I think it's trying to delete something that doesn't exist. So let's fix that as well. In the remove, we say if file is supplied, then only try to remove it. Let's save that. Delete. Okay, successful deletion. That's nice. And this is allowed only because I'm logged in as me. Otherwise, this shouldn't allow any deletion. Okay, so let's see. Now that we have done all this, let's say create a second entry and choose file. And hit submit. Look, it's much smaller now. That's right. It's a much smaller picture. This is good. Now, in order to show you further, I am going to show you that you can even use your mobile phone and upload your picture, which is the real intent, okay? So let me just deploy this. First thing, in order to do all this, we have to deploy it. Let's hit deploy. Once we hit deploy, let's wait for this to deploy. And then I am going to go to that website myself using my mobile phone. And let me see. Okay, it's been deployed. So hold on, give me a second. Okay, so now if I go to this location, I'm trying to hold on. So let me see if I can go to this location here, InstaGuest book, and it opens up and it's showing all that. Good. So now I want to visit the same place. What was it called? It's called InstaGuestBook.firebaseapp.com. So let me go there. InstaGuestBook.firebaseapp.com. So now I have the same site open in my mobile phone. So pretty soon hopefully you will see me posting a picture to it. So this is, I'm typing here, this is Jitesh from mobile phone. I'm typing here and I'm going to take a picture. Hopefully this picture will be all right. I'm looking a little weird, but this is all, I guess this is fine. So now if I took a picture and I just posted that picture and I'm hitting save. So once I submit, oh, look at that, something changed. This is Jitesh from mobile phone, but it didn't actually upload my picture. Why did it not upload my picture? I wonder why. Let me try this again. I'm basically going to upload the picture again. So I'm going to say test. So it actually, okay, this time it worked. Okay, so that was so this was taken from a phone in live real time. If I hit delete, it goes away, of course. I don't know why that one, the one from mobile phone, didn't actually go away. It's not deleting because I'm not, I think it believes that I'm not logged in, so I'm just going to log in again. Sometimes it wants me to log in again. So I hit delete, and now delete also works. So that's good. So there you go. You got an Insta guest book. Let me just post another picture, and I'm doing this from a different phone, from a different browser. That's my phone. And I am going to say, I'm going to say with a friend, hit the met. So there you go. That's me uploading, and it's actually resizing the picture. It is not posting it in its original size because of the in-browser resizer that I have. I will be posting the code for all this. Hopefully, you can see the power of Svelte. Svelte, of course, is just plain JavaScript. There is not a whole lot, but then with the await block, you are able to get the download URL and then show it in the image. All of this code will be available in the show notes in the description. I will post the code, and I want you to subscribe to this channel and also hit the notification. And the alert, the bell, and please in your comments tell me what else do you want me to write, create more videos on. This is Svelte and Firebase coming together. We were able to do the login thing, authentication in Firebase. We were able to insert records into the Firebase database, and then we were also uploading to the storage images. So this is pretty good. Allows you to, and all this is just serverless in the cloud in Firebase with the help of Svelte. Hopefully you learned something. Svelte is a great, powerful UI framework slash compiler, and it makes our life much easier. All of these things, as you could see, all we had to do was modify the records, like on snapshot. This is a one-liner. It really, just because you updated records, that is why all of this is re-rendering. You don't have to do set state like you have to do in React. You don't have to do use state and use selector and so many things that you would have to do otherwise. You don't have to do any of those things because you are using Svelte. So once again, subscribe to the channel, post your comments so that I know what other topics you want to see some videos on. And I will see you in the next video. Hope you learned something. Thank you.